From the nation's capital in Washington, D.C., the Congressional Report, with your host, Iowa Congressman Tom Latham.
This country is based on farms, on small businesses, and creating jobs and opportunities. That is the lifeblood of this nation.
And now your host, Congressman Tom Latham.
Hi, and welcome to the Congressional Report, and thank you for joining me. Every 10 years, Americans are asked to participate in a constitutionally mandated census that counts every resident in the United States. The next census will take place in 2010. On today's program, we'll give you the facts about the 2010 census so that you have all the information you need to be prepared. We'll go over how Americans can participate and how you can make sure your information is kept private. My guest today is Burton Rice of the U.S. Census Bureau. And welcome to the program, Burton. It's nice to have you. Tell us a little bit about yourself. How do you prepare yourself to work for the census?
Well, I've been working for the Census Bureau for about 11 years, since 1998. I was deeply involved in the 2000 census, and through all the planning and development of the census, I've been working with the decennial operation that was doing all of the initial preliminary work for the census, and I moved into the communications directorate a couple of years ago. I've been writing about the census and thinking about the census for quite a long time now.
We talked in the opening about, this is, the Constitution mandates the census, and why is that, or what does the Constitution say?
The Constitution, Article 1, Section 2 of the Constitution directs the Congress to ensure that a census is taken every 10 years to apportion members of Congress among the various states, and to determine how taxation is applied to the population and how funds are distributed among the population. Mm-hmm. Our founding fathers did a remarkable thing, I think. The census, prior to them coming along, the census was used as a mechanism to oppress people, to control people, primarily to pull resources from people. Our founding fathers had the wisdom to take the census and turn it around and use it as a way to provide the foundation for our democracy, to empower people, to ensure that people have equal representation, fair representation, and that they get their fair share of what government is doing and a fair participation within the government. It's really quite a remarkable thing, and it is, as you said, it's mandated by our Constitution.
Who's required to respond to the census? Everybody?
Everybody is. The census, the Constitution makes it very clear that it's residents of the United States that are counted in the census. The Supreme Court has confirmed that. A number of presidential administrations have confirmed that. So we will be taking a census of everybody who lives in the country as of April 1st, 2010.
And how do you respond to the census? What's the easiest way? Are you contacted individually, or how? The different ways, aren't there?
There are. For most of the country, beginning in March of 2010, we'll be mailing out a census questionnaire. It looks just like this. It's a short form questionnaire. It has just 10 questions on it. We'll mail this or deliver this to every household in America. Most of us, about 85% of us, live in what we call the mail out, mail back universe, where your address is the exact location where you live. And for those folks, we will mail the questionnaire. It'll show up in their mail. There are a lot of people in our country who live in more rural areas. Somebody who lives on rural Route 32, where you see mailboxes lined up, but their house is back from the road, will actually go and drop the form off at their house, and they'll be asked to, again, fill it out and mail it back. Beginning in January of next year, we will start an outreach and communications campaign and paid advertising campaign to let people know that the census is coming. So people are going to be hearing a lot about the census. And then again, as we mail out the forms will show up at their doorstep. And we really encourage people to mail the form back themselves. Fill out the form and mail it back. We get the best data when somebody sits quietly and thoughtfully at their kitchen table and thinks about who lives in their household and who they are and answers the questions that way. For those folks who do not respond or mail us back, we maintain an address list, and we know if we've gotten a form from a household or not. For those households we don't get a form, beginning in late April, we'll send out census enumerators, and they will knock on the door and do an interview, again, asking just these 10 questions on the census questionnaire.
So, in Iowa, what's the benefit for people to fill out the census? What difference does it make to the individuals?
Well, I think it's really twofold. I think this is the largest civic engagement that we undertake as a nation. It's the time when we step up and say who we are and step into our political process, into our democracy. This is how we define the House of Representatives. So it's terribly important for people to be counted, to be part of that process. But also importantly, the census is used, census data are used to disseminate federal funds. Over $400 billion of federal funds are distributed using census data every year. So, you know, determinations are made about transportation funding, for instance, based on thresholds that towns or cities or counties will meet. So if your county, for instance, exceeds 50,000 people, you qualify for additional transportation funds. It's the same for funds that are used for hospitals, for disaster preparedness, for schools, for our entire infrastructure that our country needs in order to function. The census is used to distribute those funds. So we need people to participate so that funds are distributed accurately and fairly, and people need to participate so that their communities, their towns, their cities, their congressional districts get the fair share of federal funding.
Mm-hmm. You know, I do a lot of town hall meetings, and one of the big questions is about the census is, why do they have to ask all those questions? That is too intrusive. They're asking things that... why would anybody care about this?
Right.
How do you respond to that?
Well, there are two ways that I respond to that. The census, the decennial census, the every 10-year count that we're doing, for the first time, we're doing just a short form. So there aren't going to be extensive questions. They're not going to be intrusive questions. We're not going to ask a Social Security number. We're not going to ask any questions about your finances, bank account numbers, nothing of that nature. We'll just ask, how many people live in your household? We'll ask their race, we'll ask their gender, we'll ask their ethnicity, whether they're Hispanic or not. We'll ask how long they've lived in that household. And a couple of questions that help us make sure that we're not duplicating, double counting people, or that we're counting people accurately. The intrusive questions that you hear about are questions that are linked to what used to be called the census long form.
Mm-hmm.
In prior censuses, one out of six people would have gotten a questionnaire that had 35, 40 questions on it. We've replaced the census long form with a survey we call the American Community Survey. And over, about 3 million people a year on a rolling basis now get the American Community Survey. It goes out to a random selection, a random sample of households every month. It might be every 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
Those questions are also needed, though, to understand, for us to be able to, for governments and for urban planners and for businesses to be able to understand the communities that they're serving and that they're living in. So it might be unusual to hear that you're getting a question, how many toilets are there in your
right.
house? But for somebody who's building a sewage system, that's important information. All of the questions on the census questionnaire, both this short form that I've been talking about and the American Community Survey, are required by congressional mandate. We don't ask any question that Congress doesn't ask us to ask. And all the questions are tied to federal programs, to programs that are important to our infrastructure, are important to our society.
What if someone doesn't respond? What are the consequences? There's penalty of jail or whatever. Is that going to happen?
There's a penalty. The penalty is a fine of it used to be up to not more than $100. It was increased to not more than $5,000. The Census Bureau is not a prosecuting agency. It's the Department of Justice that would make the decision about whether to prosecute or not if somebody adamantly chose not to respond. We will do everything we can to work with people to get the information to get them to cooperate with us. As I said earlier, if somebody doesn't send in their form, we'll go and knock on their door. And hopefully we'll try different times of the day. We might make phone calls. We'll try to get them to answer mm-hmm. these simple 10 questions.
In a state like Iowa, we usually have a pretty high cooperation
yes,
rate.
Yes, we do.
And I think we're actually maybe number one in the country. But if the census, someone will come to your door if you don't, and how do you know if this is a legitimate census person?
That's a good question. Census enumerator will be carrying an official census bag. It'll say 2010 census on it. They'll have an identification, a official government identification. If someone is still concerned, they can ask for a phone number. They can call the local census office or the regional census center to ensure that the person that is coming to their door is a census enumerator. And again, that person is only going to ask the 10 questions on the census questionnaire. And you can go and confirm what those questions are online. We'll send you a sample questionnaire if you wish. You'll have the questionnaire perhaps in your house if you haven't sent it back. So it will be very clear that the person is asking just those 10 questions, and it should not take very long for them to ask those questions and get the information from the household.
I've heard people have some concern. They'll have someone walk up to their door with a GPS what's that all about?
We used handhelds. The census begins by defining the address list. We had census enumerators walking or census employees walking every street in America using a GPS device to get the GPS coordinates of each address on our address list. And that's what we use that handheld device for. They will not be using those handheld devices any longer in census operations. They will come to the door with a clipboard and a pencil, mm-hmm. and they will ask the questions and fill out a form as you answer the questions. There won't be any handheld devices for that operation.
But the purpose of that was to say that there actually is a house here, that there is whatever physical structure it is or
correct.
Not.
Correct.
So you know exactly this is an honest
exactly.
census.
And you know, one of the biggest challenges of the census is not just that we have to count everybody. We have to count them once, only once, and in the right place. We have to actually identify where that person is, because again, where that person, the numbers and the geographic coordinates of where people live are what are used to disseminate federal funds, and they're used to draw congressional districts and apportion members among the House of Representatives, as I said. Those address lists and that map that we use to drive the census is some of the most sophisticated maps in the world. And your Yahoo Maps, your Google mm-hmm. Maps all use census data to draw those maps and to be able to provide the GPS coordinates, to provide directions for you through your GPS devices. You'll mm-hmm. notice that those got a lot better over the last 10 years. Big part of the reason why is that we brought our whole map into GPS alignment. And that's what those people were doing as they walked around the country with those handheld devices.
Is the census this time going to actually count everyone, or is there any kind of estimates that there are so many people in this area? Like, that was a big discussion. I know 10 years
certainly
ago
was
a
and,
huge
and,
debate.
And the Supreme Court determined that for apportioning members of Congress among the states, the Constitution makes it very clear that it must be a direct enumeration of the population. There is no adjustment. There's no statistical adjustment of the population. Mm-hmm. What they often called sampling, right. to adjust the census counts after the enumeration was complete. That was considered by the Census Bureau in an earlier decade. The Census Bureau determined after the census that even for other uses of census data, it really wasn't feasible to adjust the counts. And there is no plan in the 2010 census to do any kind of adjustment in the census.
I remember 10 years ago, that was a huge debate.
I remember also.
The potential for someone to manipulate the numbers for maybe political reasons
right.
or whatever
right.
was a big concern. How do folks know that this information that you give them is going to be private, whether you're talking about the longer form
right.
or the regular census form?
Census data are confidential by law. Title 13 of the U.S. Code requires that census data be only used for aggregate statistical purposes. Everybody who works for the Census Bureau, everybody who works with census data, myself included, swears an oath, a lifetime oath, that we will not divulge any confidential mm-hmm. information to anyone. We face a fine of up to $500,000 and imprisonment, and I'm not going to remember now how long it is, but it's but 10 or 12 years, something mm-hmm. like that, if we were to violate that oath of confidentiality. Beyond that, we have extensive IT security firewalls, multiple firewalls around census data to ensure that nobody can hack into the census data. And I think it's of paramount importance. It's a fundamental commitment to everybody who works for the census that the data be maintained confidentially and that the data be as accurate as possible. The notion of manipulating the data for any kind of purpose is anathema to anybody who works for the Census Bureau. Mm-hmm. I cannot emphasize that enough. That ethic really drives the work that we do. we place our professional our professional integrity is rests on producing the most accurate data we possibly can.
That is all the data that you bring together, is that in general, is that available to the public, or how, I mean, after the census is over with,
right,
can you go in and look at your community?
Absolutely. All census data are available through what we call the American Fact Finder. They're available online. There's a state data center in every state and census information centers in most cities that will help people navigate those IT systems, those online systems, to learn about the data of their community. There are people who are happy to answer questions when you call the Census Bureau. Census data are for the public. Census data are for the Congress to govern, for all levels of government to govern, for businesses to plan, for scholars to understand the impact of social programs or businesses or changes in the economy. Hmm. We produce some of the best data in the world. And that's in large part because of the information produced by the Census Bureau. And since we have an internet now, that's far more available than it's ever been to people. But that's our primary goal. Census data are for everyone.
Hmm. Just when exactly does the census start? I mean, is it February 1st or something? And when do you when do you cut it off?
Right. Census Day is April 1st. Every 10 years, we take a snapshot of the American people. This year, we're calling it a portrait of America, as of April 1st. So when you get your form in March, you're asked to fill the form out. In fact, it says the census must count every person living in the United States on April 1st, 2010. So that's the day. The census will be starting before that as it arrives at the doorstep. Some operations where we have to do different things to enumerate people will be underway at that time. The non-response follow-up operation, where I talked about earlier about people going to people's houses who don't return a form, that'll be winding up in June.
Is there a concern about losing identity theft or anything with the census being involved for individuals?
That's a very good question. There certainly have been scams, there will be scams, and that's why it's important that people understand that the census is not being taken online. If you get an email asking for information, that's not the Census Bureau asking for that information, even if they call it a census. This is the census form. This is going to come to your doorstep. Or a census enumerator might ask you questions who identified as a member of the Census Bureau staff. No other type of mailing that you get that says the census, no email, no internet overtures to provide information is a valid census operation. And again, the census does not ask any of, or most of the information that's important for identity theft, the census does not ask.
Right.
If you're asked for your Social Security number, it's not the Census Bureau asking it. For any of the surveys, not just the decennial, but certainly for the decennial. Mm-hmm. You're asked for your bank account number. If you're asked for how much money you make or where you spend your money, these are not questions that are asked on the census, 2010 census questionnaire.
If someone calls your house, the census is never going to ask you to give information over the telephone.
Will they call?
How do you know that that's real or not?
They will identify themselves and make it very clear, and they will explain what it is that they're asking and why they're asking. We have a coverage follow-up operation where if we have questions about the form or if you have more than six people living in your household, we will call back to get, we'll ask for their names, and we'll call back to get further information about them. Again, it's just the 10 questions on the questionnaire. And most people won't be called. Virtually everybody is going to get the form or have somebody knock on their door and talk to them.
Is there any potential for politics to get involved in the census? I mean, how do you set the firewall on that?
The census is very important for politics, but the process is apolitical.
Right.
And I think that everybody that I've ever worked with at the Census Bureau holds that as a fundamental obligation, that the census is about producing the most accurate data possible. I've worked for 11 years at the Census Bureau I'm in the third administration. The census is not about meeting a particular political ideology on either side of the spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
We work with everybody. We are reaching out to every member of Congress to help us, Democrat and Republican alike. We work with organizations through our partnership program that help mobilize their constituencies and get the word out to their constituents about the importance of the census. And we work with a wide variety of organizations. Anybody who wants to help us get the word about the census, for the most part, we will work with that organization, whether it's the NRA or the NAACP or the Mexican American Legal Defense Fund or the U.S. Conference of Mayors. Runs the gamut, the full spectrum of organizations in the country.
And you contract out, and I don't want to make this at all political, but groups like ACORN had a relationship before, and apparently they don't this time.
They don't have a relationship any longer because aspects of what ACORN were doing was doing of things ACORN was doing that were in the news were getting in the way of the census, and that's really the problem. But you said contract, and I think it's important to emphasize that no partner working with the Census Bureau gets a contract. We don't contract with these organizations. These are organizations that want to work with us to help get the word out.
On a voluntary
basis. And we work with them to provide materials that they can send out to their constituents, much like we work with your office and provide materials that your staff can send out to your constituents. But they don't contract with us. They're not doing the census. Anybody who applies to work for the Census Bureau undergoes a thorough background check, the most rigorous background check we've ever implemented. We're not contracting with organizations to do the census.
Okay,
that's a very important.
Now, how many people are you hiring, and are your needs filled as far as employees for next year?
We're always recruiting, but we'll be recruiting through January and February of next year to hire the staff that will be conducting the enumeration through the non-response follow-up operation. Those will number close to 500,000 that will have 500,000 people in the field at any given moment. We will fill 1.4 million jobs for the full scope of the census. That includes some of the operations I've already talked about. I'd be happy to provide you with numbers for Iowa, and I don't have them with me.
Right.
I could have thought to do that.
There are some full-time, there's some part-time.
There's some part-time. The interviewing positions, the enumerators, are part-time positions, and they're a temporary job. They're a job that will last from 4 to 10 or 12 weeks. On our website at 2010census.gov, there is information about how to apply for census jobs, and we have a recruiting operation that will be out recruiting census enumerators. One of the things that we have a commitment to doing is to hiring people who come from the communities where they're going to be doing the enumeration.
Mm-hmm.
You're far more likely to cooperate with somebody
if
they know you.
Yeah,
I mean, maybe not going to know them, but they're going to live in the county you live in. So we strive to hire locally because that's where we get our best employees for the local work that we're doing. So our recruiting operation will be in every community in January and February of next year to field that staff. As it was for the address canvassing operation I described earlier.
If someone feels that there's something kind of wrong with this, either this person at their door or they get something in the mail, is there a hotline or something?
And they should go to 2010census.gov, and there will be they can find a phone number for their local jurisdiction, so the regional office that they can call to ask questions of somebody to make sure that the people there are legitimate census employees.
So if someone's asking you questions like your bank account number or your credit card
number, I can confirm that they are not census employees.
Okay. If you fill out the form and you miss a couple questions or something like that, it's incomplete in what you submit, is it they're going to follow up again with
they
you?
May. They may call you. They may call your household and ask you for those questions. We'll do everything we can to get information as complete as possible. We will tabulate the best information we can from the forms that we get back. We ask people to fill out the whole form.
The American Community Survey that you talked about before, and that's the one I hear most about.
I understand that, yeah.
Constituents are very concerned about a lot of questions that that they don't believe are relevant,
right.
I guess, as far as why does the government need to know this. But now you said, to plan for, say, sewage systems in a community or whatever. Whatever else kind of questions do you?
The questions, as I said, every question on the American Community Survey is a question that Congress is required to fulfill a congressional mandate. The questions will have to do with your ancestry, because that's important for us to, for people to understand where people come from, who they are. There are questions about how many people live in your household, like the census. There are questions about their transportation patterns, so that transportation can be mapped out or planned effectively for the community. They're all questions that are oriented around the infrastructure and the government programs and the infrastructure requirements for the communities that are being served at every level of geography.
Well, one question I also get a lot at town hall meetings, things like that. If you're in this country illegally, are you supposed to fill out a census form? Is it for legal residents? Is it just for citizens? Is it just for whoever's
here? The census
here?
Counts all the residents that live in the United States.
No matter what their status is.
No matter what their status is.
Okay. Is that a big concern as far as trying to reach those individuals, because sometimes they're very concerned about somebody coming to their door?
They are. Our partners work with us to help those folks understand that the census is safe, that the census is confidential, that the census is important. We are mounting a widespread communications operation to get the word out. We're advertising in many languages, in 28 languages. We have language assistance guides in 59 languages, so that people who are living here, whatever their circumstances are, we work to help them understand that we want them to respond to the census. We want to include them in the census counts. That's our constitutional obligation.
Okay. I tell you, this is a huge issue. I think Iowa next time potentially will lose one of our, we currently have 5 congressional districts. We may go to 4. We haven't grown as quickly as some other parts of the country, but it's a huge issue. It's a major thing that people need to do to make sure that we are represented, and that affects so much of how everything is distributed in the federal government.
It does.
Thank you very much, Burton, for being
Thank
with
you.
Us.
It's
appreciate
a privilege
it.
To
very,
be here. Thank you very much.
It.
We really appreciate your support of the census and the work you do to help us get this job done.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our Constitution requires every United States resident to take part in the census every 10 years. The process guides the federal government on a wide range of issues that have a direct impact on you and your community. If you have any questions or concerns about the 2010 census, please contact my office or visit my website. All my contact information will be available at the end of this program. I'd like to thank my special guest, Burton Rice, one more time, and to thank you for joining me. I hope you'll tune in again next time on the Congressional Report.
From the nation's capital in Washington, D.C., this has been the Congressional Report with Iowa Congressman Tom Latham. Have a question, comment, or concern? Congressman Latham wants to hear from you.